Hello friends, in this video we will learn more numericals on AC circuits. Question number 1 is now appeared on your screen. It says find RMS value of V of t equal to 2 minus 3 root 2 cos of 10 t plus 45 degree plus 3 cos of 10 t. Let's see how to solve this. In case signal is given in trigonometric form and if they are asking you what is RMS value, then we have a standard form to be followed. For example, I can express V of t in general as V of t equal to a naught plus summation n equal to 1 to infinity. I can say a n cos n omega naught t plus b n sine of n omega naught t. I'm sure you must have recognized this is what we called as a Fourier series. After expanding, it may look like this. A naught plus. Now here, I will be substituting n equal to 1 to infinity in a given term. So it will get expanded as a1 cos omega naught t plus a2 cos of 2 omega naught t and so on. We don't know how many cos terms are there in general. Similarly, you will get b1 sine n omega naught t plus b2 sine of 2 omega naught t. Here, in fact, we can substitute as n equal to 1 plus continuing up to bn part. In that case, RMS value is under root of a naught square plus half. Then in the bracket, it is a1 square plus a2 square and so on. Also, b1 square plus b2 square and so on. And this is how we actually get VRMS value. So in this case, a naught is what we called as a DC part. So we know the fact that Fourier series actually expresses the given sinusoidal signal into a DC part as well as sinusoids. Sinusoids means in terms of cos and sine, where omega naught is called as a fundamental frequency. So if your signal is appearing to be a Fourier series part, then what you need to do is you'll have to calculate RMS value equal to under root of DC part square plus half, and then in the bracket you'll have to take every amplitudes of individual, that is a1, a2 square plus b1 square plus b2 square and so on, and then you'll have to multiply by half, and this is what we get RMS value. Let's compare the given sum with a standard format now. As you can see, V of t is equal to 2 minus 3 root 2 cos of 10 t plus 3 cos of 10 t, out of which I can recognize this 2 is a DC part. Whereas, as you can see, there are two cos terms, but the problem is that both of them are sharing a same frequency, that is 10 t and 10 t. Now, we need to modify this somehow. We'll see how to tackle this problem. 2 minus 3 root 2 cos of 10 t plus 45 degree plus 3 cos of 10 t. The problem is that this frequency and this frequency is same. We cannot have two separate cos components having same frequency. We can have multiple cos components, but they should have different frequencies. So let's see how we can handle this. I can in fact apply cos of a plus b formula. You all are aware, cos a cos b minus sine a sine b is nothing but cos of a plus b. So let's see, expanding this, I'll get 3 root 2 as it is. This term I will expand as cos of 10 t cos of 45 minus sine of 10 t sine of 45 plus 3 cos of 10 t. So cos of 45, we know it is 1 by root 2. Similarly, sine 45 is also 1 by root 2. So now I shall actually open the bracket. So I can write 2 minus 3 root 2 times cos of 10 t dot 1 by root 2. Negative, and this negative will become positive and now it becomes 3 root 2 sine of 10t, and sine of 45 is 1 by root 2 plus 3 cos of 10t. So here you can see root 2 is getting cancelled, root 2 gets cancelled. Also, now this term, that is minus cos 10t and plus 3 cos 10t may get cancelled. So even these two terms gets cancelled. So the remaining term is 2 plus 3 sine of 10t. So this is the final series now we have. Now I can go for VRMS value, which is straight away equal to DC part square, which is 2 square plus half, and then I can take 3 square. So after solving this, you will get 2.9 volt. So VRMS is 2.9 volt. I'm sure you understood this problem. Now we can move to the next problem. Question number 2 is now appeared on your screen. It says I of t is equal to 2 plus 3 cos of 100 t plus 45 degree plus 4 sine of 200 t plus 60 degree. Like a previous problem, now this is not an issue because even though there is cos and sine term, both of them are not sharing a same frequency. Am I right? So we can directly go on applying the formula here. So I can say now IRMS, it's simply equal to under root of DC part square, which is 2 square plus half, and then this 3 we can take 3 square plus, now this 4 we can include 4 square. Further you can write it is 4 plus half, this is 9 plus 16, and when you will solve this you'll get 4.06 ampere. This is how you should handle when you have to get VRMS and IRMS if Fourier series is given to you. Let's move to the next problem now. Question number 3 is appeared on your screen. It says you'll have to find I value for a given circuit. So as you can see, it is simple RL circuit. Voltage across L is given as 8 volt here. We can have this polarity. As well as the supply voltage is given as 10 volt. Let me tell you, if the angle is 0 degree, you can remove that angle and you can write it as 10 volt. But if the angle is other than 0 degree, then you'll have to consider that. In this case, you'll have to find current I. Since it is a series circuit, it means current through R as well as L will be same. Let's see what we can do with this. Suppose this voltage is VR, that is voltage across R. So we are pretty sure that total voltage is given as vector addition of VR and VL, or magnitude wise I can say it is under root of VR square plus VL square. Is that right? This is nothing but magnitude of V. As you can see, the supply voltage magnitude is given, it is 10 volt. So I can substitute 10 equal to under root of VR square plus VL square. As you can see, VL is given as 8 volt, so 8 square is 64. Square in on the both the sides, you get VR square plus 64 equal to 100, or you can write VR square equal to 36. In a way, you can write now VR equal to 6 volt. Now it becomes very simple. Voltage across R is known, as well as the resistor value is known. What we need to calculate is only I. In that case, by applying Ohm's law, I is simply voltage across R divided by R itself gives you current. Voltage across R is 6, resistor value is 2. If you calculate, you'll get I equal to 3 ampere. As you can see, 3 ampere is option C, and option C is the correct answer. Let's move to the next problem now. In question number 4, you have to find the value of I for a given circuit. As you can see, I is nothing but the supply current. Just check, I is a supply current. Thereafter, it is inductor L having 1 by 3 Henry value. Capacitor C value is not given, but voltage across capacitor is given, which is 3 at an angle of 0 degree. By observation, we can say that if voltage across capacitor is 3 at an angle of 0 degree, since inductor and capacitors are connected in parallel, we know the fact that voltage across parallel circuit is always same, meaning that I can consider voltage across inductor also 3 at an angle of 0 degree. Or as I said, if the angle is 0 degree, you can actually ignore that angle and you can say plus minus 3 volt only. Am I right? After this, inductor value is known, but reactance value of the inductor is not known. But we know the fact that XL is given by simply omega times L. Or I can write XL equal to omega is given 3 into L value is given 1 by 3 Henry. 3 gets cancelled. XL becomes 1 ohms. I'm sure you understand that. XL is nothing but inductive reactance, which is given by omega into L. Omega stands for operating frequency. As you can see, the current which is supplied, that is operating current, is having frequency as 3 radians per second. So I can substitute that. In a way, I got XL value. Let's see what we can do now. Suppose if I manage to get current through L, then everything will become easy, because current through capacitor is already known to me. Current through L and current through C can have vector addition, which will give me together the total current I. So somehow I have to get IL value now. Current IL is nothing but vector value. I can say voltage across L, that is vector value, divided by ZL vector. So current through L is equal to voltage across inductor, as we can write as a vector value, 3 at an angle of 0 degree, divided by ZL vector is nothing but XL at an angle of 90 degree. I'm sure you know this. XL is 1 at an angle of 90 degree. It means now I can write IL vector as 3 at an angle of minus 90 degree ampere. So what is known to me is now IL vector value. So now, here, this is IL vector, this is IC vector, so I can now have this I vector also. So by KCL, I can say I vector is nothing but IL vector plus IC vector, which gives me I vector equal to IL vector is 3 at an angle of minus 90 degree plus IC. IC means current through capacitor is nothing but 4 at an angle of 90 degree, which was actually given. We know the fact that when the vector values are polar values, we should actually go for multiplication or division. But if you want to go for addition or subtraction, we should prefer rectangular values. Right now, I'm actually doing vector addition, so they should be rectangular value. So I can indicate 3 at an angle of minus 90 degree as minus 3j plus 4 at an angle of 90 degree as 4j. So how much I vector I will get? I vector is simply 1j, or in polar form I can write that as 1 at an angle of 90 degree ampere. As you can see, I vector is 1 at an angle of 90 degree, where option number A is correct option. So you should understand that. This is for your reference I am providing you. If it is 1j, it is always 1 at an angle of positive 90 degree, and if it is minus 1j, I can write it as 1 at an angle of minus 90 degree. Similar way, I can represent 3 at an angle of minus 90 degree as minus 3j, whereas 4 at an angle of positive 90 degree as positive 4j. So 4 minus 3j, that is 4j minus 3j becomes positive j, and 1j is nothing but 1 at an angle of 90 degree. The reason why we have back converted into polar values, because options were given in polar values. So you have to adopt yourself according to the options given. I'm sure you understood this problem. It was very easy. Let's move to the next problem now. Question number 5 is now appeared on your screen. It says, consider following circuit. I1 leads I2 by an angle. And options are given 45 degree, 90 degree, 60 degree or 135 degree. We'll see how to handle this. The supply voltage is not given, but the supply voltage frequency is given, which is 2 radians per second. In a way, it is nothing but your operating frequency. In first branch, it is RL circuit, and the second branch is capacitor C. Current through first branch is I2, current through second branch is I1, and they are asking you actually relation between I1 and I2 in terms of phase. Whenever the question is about phase, always try to solve the problem by drawing vector diagram for a given circuit. As you can see, since it is a parallel circuit, I will take voltage as a reference, because we know the fact that when it comes to parallel circuit, voltage is common. When it comes to series circuit, current is common. So when current is common, we take current as a reference value and we draw the vector diagram. Whereas when it's a parallel circuit, we go for voltage as a reference and we draw rest of the currents and voltage for drawing a vector diagram. Since it's a parallel circuit, let's have voltage as a reference value. So this V, that is plus minus V, I can have as a reference value V vector. This V is nothing but voltage across this also, as well as voltage across this capacitor also, right? Let's talk about current I1. What could be the relation between voltage across capacitor and current through the capacitor? I'm sure you must have seen previous videos where I have made you understand how to get voltage and current relation when it comes to capacitor or resistor or inductor. Also, we have seen combinations also. So we know the fact that when it comes to capacitor, current always leads voltage across it by 90 degree. I repeat my statement, current through capacitor always leads by 90 degree. I repeat, current through capacitor always leads by 90 degree with respect to voltage across it. So I can now draw I1 this way. This is I1 vector, because we know the fact that I1 always leads voltage by 90 degree. Now, let's talk about RL circuit, because the first branch, as you can see, it's a RL circuit. We know the fact that for RL circuit, current always lags to the voltage. So, as you can see, what is the current through this branch is I2. So, I2 will lag voltage by some angle, let's say phi. We should understand that this phi is nothing but phase angle between voltage and current. It is also called as, in fact, impedance angle. Let's try to concentrate on the question. Question says, you have to find I1 is leading by I2 by how much angle. So as you can see, I1 with respect to V relation, we know it is 90 degree phase. If I manage to get phi value, then 90 plus 5 will become angle between I1 and I2. So it is very important to find this angle, which is also called as impedance angle. So let's see how to get impedance angle for RL circuit. Impedance angle 5 is simply tan inverse of XL by R, or tan inverse of XL is given by omega L upon R. So it is tan inverse of, check it out, what is omega? It is 2. What is L? It is 1, divided by R value is also 2. So it becomes tan inverse of 1. So we know the fact that phi becomes 45 degree. By referring to this vector diagram, I can say I1 leads I2 by an angle 90 plus phi. So check, what is phi value? 45 degree. So if you add 90 plus 45, it will become 135 degree. Now we can say 135 degree is the correct answer. That is, I1 is leading I2 by how much degree? It was 90 plus 5. Phi was impedance angle. Impedance angle of RL circuit is given by tan inverse of XL by R. When we calculated 5, 90 plus 5 becomes 135 degree, which is option number D. I'm sure you have understood all these problems. Thank you.